In his two-volume History of Unitarianism, Earl Morris Wilbur, longtime president of Star King's School in Berkeley, identified freedom, tolerance, and reason as the essential principles that we have espoused in religious life across the centuries. When we turn to our own congregations, the question becomes, how do these great principles, when enshrined as idols, work their subtle tyranny and undermine the social effectiveness of our faith? Consider freedom. Is there more than a semantic difference between religious liberalism and liberal religion? Are we liberals who happen to gather in churches, or religious people who practice our religion according to liberal principles? Religious liberalism places emphasis upon the substantive, liberalism, reducing religions to a mere adjective. When this happens, the dimensions of our faith become modifiers secondary to an isolated precept, which, when abstracted from the whole, becomes an idol. The idol of a political ideology, or worse, the idol of a possessive individualism. Following the precedent of our 19th century forebears, we Unitarian Universalists have come to trust and place great value on freedom and individualism. What we tend to forget is that they emphasized freedom in order to liberate themselves from bondage. Today, our problem is not bondage, but bondlessness. Most of us are already free. We don't need more freedom. We need the resolve to employ the freedom we have responsibly. We need to invest a little of our precious freedom and bond ourselves to others in redemptive community.
Freedom and tolerance and reason. These have historically been three of the core values that Unitarians and Unitarian Universalists have held. And this morning, I'm only going to talk about the first one, freedom. And even that, I want to narrow from this grand abstraction to something a little smaller and a little more manageable. This morning, I want to look specifically at five religious freedoms that have shaped who we are as Unitarian Universalists, as people of faith. Now, the first freedom I want to explore with you this morning is the freedom that we have to gather in congregations and to bind ourselves by covenant as our own consciences require. Rather than being ruled by a monarch's theology or coerced into participation in their parents' religions, our Protestant dissenter forebears fought for the right to form voluntary associations. In their minds, freedom of religion meant freedom to join together for study and worship according to the dictates of their own hearts. Now, to this day, each person who becomes a member of a Unitarian Universalist conscience must join of his or her own volition. And each one may leave as his or her conscience or life path suggests that it's time. And this is equally true at the association level, where our congregational polity locates religious authority in the local congregations. Or to say that in another way, we're all independent churches. We choose to gather as an association and enter into relationship with each other through the UUA. We're not really a denomination. That's why we're the UUA, the Unitarian Universalist Association. It reminds us every time we say that name that as a local congregation and then as individuals within that congregation, we are free to make our own choices. We retain the responsibility for our own decisions. We define ourselves by our willingness to enter into covenant with one another. Now, our second freedom as Unitarian Universalists, is freedom of religious belief. And this is the freedom that leads people to quip that Unitarian Universalists can believe whatever they want. Now, the appropriate response to this quip is that, to the contrary, Unitarian Universalists are free to believe whatever their reason and conscience require. Do you see the difference? This freedom that we have as Unitarian Universalists to believe what reason and conscience require flows from a deep conviction that we have within ourselves the ability and responsibility to recognize that which is good. And because of this, we can understand what is right and true and choose it for ourselves. So as religious people, we are called to use the innate intelligence that is ours from birth and to apply both reason and creativity to matters of religion and to matters of community and to matters of politics, for that matter. We are called to weigh the truths that we are taught against our own experience and to act accordingly. Now, practically speaking, in a UU congregation, it means there's going to be a whole lot of different religious perspectives that gather in the room together on Sunday morning. There are going to be Unitarian Universalist Christians, and Unitarian Universalist Buddhists, and Unitarian Universalist Humanists, and UU Pagans, and UU Democrats, and UU Republicans, and Sufi UUs, and Hindu UUs, and Jewish UUs, and others who all sit next to each other, and all listen to the same sermon, and all work together to help to change the world. And each person who is in the room will bring his or her own theological lens and religious vocabulary. And each person who is in the room will hold on to his or her opinions and beliefs. In fact, just as our members are theologically varied, our congregations come in different theological flavors as well. Some holding close to Christian roots and liturgy, some embracing humanist perspectives and observances, some claiming pagan theologies and ritual as their starting points. Each individual and each congregation is in charge of its own celebrations. This is because we're a non-creedal faith. There's no singular belief that you have to hold to gain entry into our midst. There's no unifying statement about God or the soul or what happens after death. Because of this, people in other faith traditions often find these two freedoms, freedom of association and freedom of belief, very confusing. And it often makes it hard for us to talk about what holds us together. How can we possibly function as a faith community if people come and go as their individual faith journeys require? How can we live and work with one another in peace and goodwill if we all choose the theological metaphors that speak most clearly to our own hearts? Can there be too much freedom? Let's consider two more of our freedoms as Unitarian Universalists. These two go together. They're called the freedom of the pulpit and the freedom of the pew. Freedom of the pulpit means quite simply that UU congregations require of their clergy that they live their UU values and speak their own truths as clearly as they are able. When a minister is called to a congregation, he or she is charged to preach her conscience thoughtfully and clearly. Clearly? Clearly. I am to tell you, as a Unitarian Universalist co-religionist, where my struggles are as I strive to live from our shared values. I'm supposed to tell you what I'm thinking about, what moves me, what worries me, and why. I'm supposed to share with you my sources and my insights, and I'm to do it in a way that invites you to consider how you are living those same values or how you are struggling with similar questions. There is no assumption here that I have the answers. And there is every expectation that we will sometimes disagree. Thankfully, we need not think alike to love alike. so that even when we disagree, you should still feel my affection and esteem from the pulpit, and I should still feel yours from the pew. Now that fourth freedom, freedom of the pew, is every bit as important as the freedom of the pulpit. They require one another. Freedom of the pulpit, without the active engagement, critical attention, and clear reasoning of the congregation, is a recipe for disaster and oppression. It's the freedom of those in the pews to accept or reject, to challenge or to refine the words and ideas spoken from this pulpit that holds the minister accountable and fosters the health of the community. Just as it is the minister's freedom to comment on the ways of the congregation and how people are living their UU values that holds all of you accountable. So you called me to speak my truths and to share with you, to the best of my ability, my understanding of this faith tradition and what it requires of us, but you don't have to agree. Your belief and your interpretation of Unitarian Universalism rest with you. The whole point is that we reflect and consider and explore these things together. And if I ever thought that you were accepting what I say here on Sunday morning as gospel, I would not be able to get up here and speak about my evolving understandings and my very human explorations. Do you see how our four freedoms are mutually reinforcing? The freedom of belief is supported by the freedom of the pulpit and the freedom of the pew, and these are in turn supported by our freedom to choose our faith community and to gather in a covenant that we select for ourselves. With the freedom to hold different worldviews and celebrate different holidays, to make up our minds about theology and what happens at the end of life, what holds us together? It's a huge question. This is what I think holds us together. We share a vision of what the world should be like. We share an understanding of our purpose as a community in making that dream come true. And we voluntarily make promises to one another so that we can walk together in harmony while we're taking that journey to create that world. Unitarian Universalism isn't an easy religion. At every step of the journey, separately and together, we are called to reflect on our choices and to choose according to conscience what we will think, how we will act, what we will do. That freedom can be hard work. And so I understand the attraction of religious traditions that offer a more definitive set of guidance. And yet, you know, I like my religious freedoms, the freedom to act and believe according to my experience and reason and conscience. I love not having to preach from a lectionary or being stuck in a specific liturgical year that can't evolve the way our congregation evolves. And if I value these things for myself and more for my children and for all of us, do you see how embracing these freedoms necessarily leads Unitarian Universalists to supporting freedoms for others? What's the quote? My freedom is not secure until it is guaranteed for all people and woven into the fabric of our society. And this is what Unitarian Universalism has done for centuries now. We have worked again and again to extend our freedoms to others, to extend the existing freedoms others have to make them broader. We started by working for emancipation and for women's suffrage and for civil rights. We advocated for the rights of GLBT folks and the right to marry. We have actively supported comprehensive values-based sexuality education and a woman's right to control her own fertility. We support the individual's right to choose to die in comfort and with dignity. In every case, we have worked on the side of expanding freedom. And if you look around, as an association and as a congregation, we are still doing it. There are Unitarian Universalists in every Occupy gathering across the country. There are Unitarian Universalists who put on yellow t-shirts to stand on the side of love and to work for people whose rights are being denied because they are in this country without appropriate paperwork. Look at your new UU World when it arrives this week, and you will see some of the wonderful things we are doing. So we don't have gurus or messiahs or disciples, and we don't have any infallible creeds, and we don't have an inherited path that everybody has to follow. And we insist that each person is responsible for his or her own actions, guided by reason and by conscience. This tradition of ours has helped expand freedom in astonishing ways. What keeps us together in the midst of all that freedom? After all, people sometimes wonder if we're a religion. That word comes from relegare, to bind or to hold together. If it isn't a specific organization or a particular set of beliefs or some really wise leaders with access to the truth that bind us together, can freedom by itself hold us? In a way, I think it does. Because we freely choose to enter into relationship. And we gather in community because we share common values which we are free to express and to work for. And we gather in community because we have this shared understanding which we negotiate over and over again about what we're going to do in the world and about how we're going to treat one another. So we are free to choose the vision, and we are free to choose the goal, and we are free to choose our dreams, and we are free to choose how we will accomplish those dreams. And we are free to choose how we will treat one another during the process. And when we join the congregation, we make a choice. And some of the other options fall away because we have already chosen. The logical extension of the freedoms that we enjoy as liberal religious people is that we extend those freedoms to others and support people as they learn how to make their own decisions wisely. There were 5 freedoms, though. Were you counting? I've only given you 4. Can you guess the 5th one? It's the freedom to support the congregation of our own choosing rather than being taxed to support a state church. It is Canvas Sunday, after all. This freedom comes from a lawsuit that the Universalists brought against the Unitarians many, many years ago in New England, in which the Universalists sued not to pay taxes to support the churches of the Standing Order, which happened to be the churches that became Unitarian a generation later. The Universalists won the suit, and the tradition of passing the plate has been with us ever since. So, if you will, the morning offering will be most gratefully received, along with your generosity and enthusiasm as you participate in our spring pledge drive. Thank you.